Dr. Waddell is a good friend of mine from the University of Washington. Several of you probably know of his work with Urban Sim, and he's doing a lot more exciting things based on that now. He's now at Berkeley, and he is not only a professor in the city and regional planning department, but he's also the chair of the city and regional planning department now. And I think you're going to love this. We'd like to have him talk for a little while and have a little bit of Q&A at the end, and Paul will be around for a little while afterwards to take any additional questions. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Waddell.
Thank you. I really appreciated getting an invitation from Carrie, and I couldn't pass it out. She almost convinced me to move to her department at the University of Washington, where I decided to take a job at Berkeley. But anyway, I'm delighted to be here. I've got lots of friends here at Georgia Tech in exchange with you about work that we're doing and how it might relate to work that's going on here. So what I'm going to talk about today is a topic that I am quite interested in. Representing the pedestrian scale in integrated land use and transportation planning and modeling. So I'll explain, first of all, my motivation, why to do this. And second, give an example in a research context of how to address this in terms of parcel level residential location choices based on work that I've done with a former PhD student, Brian Lee. And then move into recent work that we've been doing to create a generalized accessibility framework that would support pedestrian scale, pedestrian and bicycling scale analysis. So I will fast forward to my California context, which I've been learning a lot about in the last 2 years since I've been in Berkeley. There is in California some of the most aggressive climate change legislation. It is the most progressive in the United States at this point. How many of you know about AB 32 SB 375? Sumro knows, and one or two others. It's legislation that's been passed in California in the last few years to essentially mandate that the greenhouse gas emissions by the year 2020 return to 1990 levels, and by 2050 to 80% below that. It's very aggressive legislation. And SB 375 says that one of the legs of the policy stool, the three-legged stool, to accomplish this will be not only to use vehicle technology and fuel technology, but to use language as a tool to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. So there's an implicit or explicit recognition that low-density, sprawl-oriented development induces additional drainage, induces more VMT and greenhouse gas emissions. And this is really what this legislation targets. And how this is playing out is that metropolitan planning agencies like UTC in the Bay Area are charged with developing a sustainable community strategies plan to coordinate land use and transport policies to reduce the need for driving and reduce greenhouse gas emissions. The issue there is how can we use land use policies and coordinate them with transportation investments to reduce the need for driving. So then we have to ask, how well prepared are we in terms of the modeling tools that are available to use them in this way? And if we look at transportation models to start with, all of them, basically that I'm aware of, with almost no exception, based on traffic analysis zones. And those traffic analysis zones are pretty large. In suburban areas, they may be a few square miles. They're definitely at a scale that it's difficult to represent. What is the real walkability of the neighborhoods that it represents and encloses? And similarly, in the transport network, travel models are based on networks designed for efficient traffic loading. And they ignore local streets. So we have collectors and arterials and highways well represented, and the transit system reasonably well represented, but with the caveat that we're not representing how people actually walk the transit or bike within that network. Okay, so these are, in my view, some real limitations, even of the cutting-edge work in activity-based travel modeling. which is still leaving assignment as a separate kind of problem. And that's often based on static assignment, origin and destinations that are aggregated up in traffic zones. And so all the rich detail that might have been used in estimating even the activity-based travel models is lost. So I think we've got some real hurdles to overcome in making models actually useful for this kind of agenda. The problems have been historically even worse in land use modeling, which had used really aggregate zones, even larger than traffic zones. And my general assumption at the end of this assessment is that we really biased our analysis away from non-motorized modes and towards, in particular, automobile modes by the way we construct the data and the models to represent that data. So I put this slide as a kind of a almost cartoon caricature of what I think is a real paradigm shift that's happening from a mobility paradigm which focuses on the highway system and focuses on level of service and identifies the problem as being congestion and the solution as being expansion of the roadway to an accessibility paradigm which is not about speed. It's about how easily you can engage in activities you want to engage in. And the point of this photograph on the right is you can actually engage in highly accessible activities walking. Speed is not the entire picture. Proximity has a lot to do with this. So land use at a microscopic level has a lot to do with how accessible things are. I ask people generally when I show the slide, where would you rather be, on the left or the right? And most people. Granted, there's a little bias in the photographs, but it's important to look and clarify ideas. Most of you have probably seen walk score, right? I find it really fascinating that this has made its way into the popular culture as having so much relevance to people. It's showing up on Zillow, is it, or Redfin, sort of real estate sites. I mean, it's important enough now that people are really actively looking at this when they're considering residential location training. To me, that's a real marker that this is not only something that's interesting from a research perspective, but it's engaging in the popular culture as well. So I think we need very high spatial detail, and I'm going to make a strong argument for it, and lay out how we're beginning to approach actually making it feasible, tractable, possible to do. Now, as we think about land use modeling, which is what I spent a fair amount of my energy in doing in the last number of years, one encounters all kinds of arguments for and against higher levels of detail. There is a strong camp that says, really, we should stick with aggregate data and aggregate zones and aggregate models. And some of the reasons they argue are that it has less data requirements, so it's easier to do. Easier to develop the models, easier to diagnose them. I tend to have some reservations about each of those claims, especially as we start taking, for example, a four-step travel model and disaggregating by more times a day, more trip purposes, and so forth, more modes, to the point that we get a very complicated model system and data structure. Some reasons to be worried about using aggregate zones in particular are something that geographers discovered some time ago, the modifiable aerial unit problem. Now, how many of you know what this idea is? So, site suit. So, a couple of people again. It's a very simple idea. The idea is that if you estimate a model that's based on aggregated zonal data, and then you change your zone structure, your parameters are no longer correct. Right? So the parameters are sensitive to the configuration of the zone. And this is something, if you're not aware of, you definitely should be if you're doing anything that uses zonal geography. A second issue that's sort of related is ecological fallacy. And here the idea is actually not about ecology so much, but it's the idea that you could take aggregate data and infer individual behavioral preferences or characteristics from aggregate data. It's fundamentally wrong. Right? So these two things tend to happen, I think, more easily. It's easier to fall into these traps using aggregate data. And thirdly, wonking is generally below the radar, if you will, in these aggregate models. And I think that biases the models in ways that are pretty well understood now. Intrazonal trips tend to be underrepresented and problematic for travel models. Transit trips that have walk access, we clearly have trouble representing how people get to transit by walking. And when we don't represent local streets, it just adds a little bit more of a problem. On the flip side, I don't think anything's a free lunch. And on the flip side, the arguments in favor and against using a detailed level of geography, I believe that on this slide. The arguments in favor are what you might predict from what I've already said about the zonal geography. At the parcel level, data is becoming more readily available. Assessor files are public, generally, and increasingly they're digitized, so you've got good cartographic representation of the parcel boundaries, every unit of land ownership. They're a real unit. When somebody buys a property, they're buying a parcel, a single-family house, or if it's a condominium, they're buying a unit that's within a building on a parcel. So it's much more closely related to the actual behaviors we're interested in modeling, also location choices, real estate development choices. And finally, I think it's easier to reconcile with policies. When you look at local plans for land use, they're specified at a level that overlays parcels. They don't overlay zones. Traffic analysis zones are totally irrelevant for land use plans, and anybody that's looked at zoning and land use plans would conclude that. But, clearly, there's a downside to using parcel data. It's messy. It's voluminous. There's a lot of missing data in it. Every city has their own standard for how to code their data, so there's no standard at all. And there's a lot of cross-referencing and mapping that has to be done to make it usable on a more regional scale. So I would estimate roughly that using current technology, it takes at least 2 years to pull usable parcel data set together on a regional scale, such as Atlanta's region. Now, the good news is a lot of people are working hard on this already. And my guess is you've already got very usable data in the Atlanta region that's been put together by people at the university and at ARC and so forth. So the sunk costs may already have been expended. To clarify ideas a little bit, these are some of the geographies that have been used in land use and travel modeling. This is some snapshots I took of imagery in the Puget Sound. The traffic analysis zones are outlined in blue. You can see they're fairly large. You can see in the one on the right, grid cells of 150 meters. And you can see in the one on the right, in particular, the parcel boundaries. But these are three alternative geographies we could consider using. Grid cells are more fine-grained than zones, and they have some advantages of being able to make very rapid queries around the grid cell. If you've done any spatial analysis in a raster GIS, you know that's a forte of that kind of approach. The downside is that parcel geography doesn't nest very nicely into grids. So when you overlay an arbitrary grid on any geography, you expect it's going to do violence to the underlying data. So to use parcel level data, even in a raster environment, you have to split parcels and do things that make the data messy. So I've used zonal data, and I've used grid cell level data, and I've used parcel data. And I'm advocating for using parcel data at the lowest level of analysis and aggregating more neatly up. So I'm going to transition to a brief discussion of one application of land use model component, the residential location component, that applies the modeling at a parcel level, just to give a little sense of flavor to where this kind of work is going. And this was done with Brian Lee, a former PhD student of mine who's now at the University of Vermont, William Wong, a postdoc at Berkeley, and Ron Pindiella at Arizona State. So accessibility, as I think most of you would appreciate is really the connecting glue between land use and transport, and between modeling of those things. So we're trying to focus on how to measure different kinds of accessibilities and figure out how important they are in a particular outcome. In this case, the outcome is the residential location choice. There are some vigorous debates going on in the literature, they have been going on for a while, about whether accessibility is really that important anymore in people's residential location choices. If you look at the work of Juliana Small or Gordon Richardson, they have made claims that due to things like the multi-worker problem, where it's harder to think about how you minimize commute time, and they have dispersed workplaces, and competition with access to other amenities, school quality, quality parks and public services more generally, all of those things weigh into people's decisions about where to live. And so they're advancing the claim that accessibility is really no longer so relevant. We have highly developed transportation systems. They're very redundant. And at some level, it doesn't matter anymore. You can live in a variety of different neighborhoods, and those other things matter more than accessibility. That's the argument. I tend to be suspicious of those claims, and I'm interested in exploring whether or not they have validity if you measure things carefully and model them appropriately. So in particular, I was interested in the question of non-work accessibility in this particular paper. We read a lot about workplace accessibility, and that's a fundamental part of urban economics. But very little has been written and studied about non-work accessibility. So it's kind of an outlandish question to even think about whether your non-work accessibility influences your residence. But that's exactly what we set out to test, controlling other factors. So we developed a parcel-level database over four counties, about 6,000 square miles, 3.5 million people, and used an activity travel survey from 2006, which we geocoded. We had 2 days of travel diary data for 4,700 households, and we were able to construct then tours that households persons in them made from home to work via the coffee shop and the store on the way home, school drop-off and pick-up, all those kinds of things that relate to trip chaining activity that people engage in. And so, in particular, we're going to focus on this return trip home, where we find that a lot of the activity that people engage in that is non-work-related trips is non-work activity takes place. So some of the trip profiles we encountered here, work tours represented 34% of the total number of tours, and of those, 50%, just over 50%, had at least one stop. Okay, there weren't that many that had two or more, but and the highest fraction of those that made a stop made it on the way home after work. So it gave us a kind of a basis to focus on the afternoon. So back to the household location choice problem. It's a thorny little problem because households have a lot of alternatives. So when you look for a property, you could choose an individual unit in a building on a parcel in a neighborhood, anywhere in the region. There's a lot of alternatives out there. So what we're doing in this case is a building level construction of the alternatives. So a household is choosing a building, which sits on a parcel. And we look at the attributes of the alternatives, including building-specific qualities and price, and control for neighborhood and accessibility attributes, all the way down to the parcel level, with some caveats that I'll explain a little later. Now, to flesh out the idea of accessibility, most of the work that's been done on measurements of accessibility are what I will refer to as generalized or regional accessibility. They're place-specific, not person-specific. So if you say I'm at a particular location, you might measure things such as how easily I can reach a variety of destinations, how many jobs are there within 30 minutes travel time from this location, for example. That's a generalized accessibility. Trip weighted travel time to different kinds of opportunities is another generalized accessibility. the log sum from a mode choice model to alternative destination. That's a generalized accessibility. Okay? An individual specific accessibility is different in the sense that it can take into account differences in the way individuals might perceive accessibility. A particular and very important aspect of this is the individual's commute to work. You might not care so much about how many jobs in general are accessible to you, but how long does it take you to get to your workplace or to your school? Okay. So that's an individual specific. And what we wanted to bring into this work is some both very old work that's been built on more recently in time-space geography by Hyderstrand. And those of you that have been looking into activity-based travel modeling, the direction that most travel models are going these days, this is often building on this concept of a time-space prism. And it really helps to understand trip chain behavior. Why it is that you might not take an errand on your lunch hour because you have to be leaving from work, going and having your lunch, getting that errand accomplished or not, and getting back to work within a particular window of time. So you have a time constraint. And how rapidly you can move about and engage in activities further bounds the activities that you can engage in. Okay? So this concept is actually pretty powerful. And it has time and space that apply constraints onto your accessibility measurement. Right? I hope this is coming across clearly. So if I'm at home, I stay home for a certain amount of time, I better travel to my workplace, I better be at work for a certain amount of time, and then when I leave work, I need to be at home at time T4, right? And that's at a different location. But in that window of time between when I leave work and when I need to be at home, I can do things. I can go to a restaurant, I can go to a grocery store, I can run an errand, or I can just go straight home. But I can measure how many kinds of activities I could engage in that prism. Okay? So that's a measure of accessibility that's bounded for the individual based not only on their characteristics and their location, but their location in time and place. Okay? There's a very interesting concept, and we wanted to test whether or not it would be a useful way to represent non-work accessibility and measure it in the context of residential location. So the way we did it, considering that we're using a travel model that, unfortunately, is based on traffic analysis and has a skeletal transport network, all those things that I just complained about. I still have to complain about them here. So this is the caveat I mentioned earlier. But on the land use side, we went down to the parcel one. And so what we were able to do is identify a set of zones that could be reached within the time-space prism and apply those constraints, and then using travel speeds from the travel network, be able to identify the opportunity set. So we looked in particular at retail, food, and other service sectors to identify the kinds of destinations that people might be going to in the afternoon peak. You're not going to be able to read this slide, and I don't want to spend the time to talk about it in detail, but it's a list of the variables we use. I'm going to focus on accessibility variables. But we also took into account all kinds of other factors that influence residential location choices. The income of the household, the number of workers, whether they have children or not, and how those things interact with things like housing price and density of the neighborhood and accessibility of the neighborhood and so on. And the social composition of the neighborhoods. So again, I'm going to skip the coefficients table at large and focus just on the accessibility variables since that's the focus of this talk. The top variable here is a generalized accessibility variable. So this is one of those that I describe as being from a place and independent of your individual characteristics. What is the general disutility of travel across different modes to workplaces? Okay, so it's a generalized accessibility, and it turns out to be significant. It's statistically significant and makes sense. We then added a more local measure, neighborhood shopping. This is as the crow flies within a quarter of a mile. How many retail jobs are there within that radius that are roughly walkable without measuring the details of exactly how they're configured along the the street. And we found that that also came in as significant. So when we added that, the first variable maintained its significance, but we also found that there was a local effect from neighborhood shopping. We then added the individual commuter's work travel time. This is now an individual level variable. And we find that it comes in as extremely significant, has a very high t-value. And it turns out in some diagnostics to be a very powerful variable. And then we added this non-work accessibility variable using the time-space prism. So how many opportunities do you have to engage in activities on your way home from work, given your actual workplace or the workplace that's given us? And we found that that also turned out to be statistically significant. So I think this shows fairly clearly that at the level we can measure people's propensities to make different residential location choices, a variety of different accessibility measures actually all contribute, in addition to attributes of the house and attributes of the neighborhood and the social demographic mix in it. So I think this provides some fairly strong evidence against earlier claims that I had mentioned that suggest that accessibility is no longer very relevant. I'm going to show a little sensitivity testing real quickly that gives us another way to assess the relative contributions of these variables. One of the hard things with discrete choice modeling is interpreting the coefficients. In a regression analysis, you can more readily interpret the coefficients, but in a nonlinear model like the multinomial logit, it's much harder. So we constructed a little sensitivity test where we hold each variable constant at its median, except for one at a time, and we vary it from its fifth to its 95th percentile value, and look at how that changes the utility of the outcome. And we graph that. You can see the relative contributions of the variables in a way that's a little bit more normalized and interpretable. So the largest bar is the interaction between high income and the size of the house. Not a big surprise. You have more income, you buy a bigger house. The biggest bar beyond that is a negative one. It's work travel time. This is the individual level measurement of the commute time to work. And I mentioned in an earlier conversation that we had to wrestle with how to do this in multi-worker households. Which travel time do we use? How do we combine them and so forth? We actually did a number of experiments doing weighted averages and summing them, multiplying them, and so forth. And what we found to be the most robust measure was the longest of the two travel times, if there were two or more. So in other words, whoever has the longest drive is going to complain the most about the residential location choice, and is going to influence not extending that residential location choice to a longer commute. So behaviorally, it makes pretty good sense. And we can see the time-space prism variable here, although it's statistically significant, isn't very large by comparison to the workplace choice, which, again, in relative orders of magnitude, makes sense. Okay. So I think this gives you a general sense of how different variables interact in shaping the residence location choices given this work. So we felt that we reaffirmed that accessibility still does matter in residence location choices. We also got a chance to test this time-space prism approach and think it has some theoretical appeal and does a nice job of capturing some trip-chaining behavior. It's computationally expensive, and we're trying to find ways to make it more efficient. And we were able to push the disaggregated approach quite a bit, except for limitations of the travel model that I mentioned. This is still an impediment. And this motivates some work that we're now doing that I'll transition into for a generalized framework for accessibility. So I see as the last hurdle in this to try to really disaggregate the travel model representation and our measurements of accessibility. So that's what the balance of my talk will be about. And this is work with a current PhD student of mine, Fletcher Fotai, and Dennis Lutzen, a PhD student at the Carlsberg Institute. The basis for this project is Sustainable Community Strategies Project of the MTC in the Bay Area. I already mentioned it in an early slide. And the intention here is to, in their project, to generate visualizations of alternative scenarios for attaining greenhouse gas emissions reductions. And increasingly, it is to support that with analytical modeling of land use and transportation interaction. They also have an activity-based travel model that's been developed that uses traffic analysis zones and course networks. But we wanted to be able to augment that and move beyond it to local streets, which is what we're focusing on in the slides that I'll show you here. How many of you know about OpenStreetMap? Okay, there are a number of you. So it's a wiki on a map. So anybody can register and can make corrections and can add missing elements. It's a wonderful project. It's totally open. There's nothing proprietary about it. And I'm really kind of infatuated with this project and with the style of interacting. So I talked to the person that loaded the OpenStreetMap data from the United States. It came from the Census Tiger Line file. Probably some of you know what that is and some of you don't. It's the Census Bureau's digital map. It's horrible. It's gotten better, but it's horrible. And when this person had loaded the Tiger file in the OpenStreetMap and looked at it, he was horrified. And said, no, this is not going anywhere. I'm going to leave this project alone. So he walked away. He said he came back to it about 3 months later and looked at an area that had been really, really atrocious. And we found that kind of intriguing. So we came back and looked at it again in a month, and it was radically better. 6 months later, it was a beautiful map. I mean, it's mind-boggling how this works, but by individual contributions, it has gotten to be an amazingly good product. We were able to load the OpenStreetMap network for the Bay Area, which has 463,000 street edges, and overlay that with a little over 2 million parcels. By and large, they match. They fit pretty darn well. So that made our job much, much easier to start connecting these data. And I think this is really the way of the future, to use open data and crowdsourcing to improve it. And I hope we can stir up a little discussion on those topics. I know Carrie shares a little of my sentiments there. So the basic idea here is that we want to support a buffer query and various kinds of accessibilities using the local street map to be able to grow out along the network and understand the topology of the network and how things are connected in order to really analyze walkability and walking scale metrics. So I'm going to walk through the methodology appropriately to use that metaphor. We converted the OpenStreetMap data to PostGIS, an open source database, and loaded it into our own graph structure for it. We then assigned all of our census data and business data to nodes on that OpenStreetMap graph, and have started using some algorithms developed at Carl's Rule called attraction hierarchies to do incredibly fast queries on this graph. And the idea here then is to specify a general application programming interface to allow on-demand very fast queries. All right, so the first step was to link the parcels to street nodes, and we used an ANN nearest neighbor library to do this. It runs relatively quickly, and it's a one-time process. Whenever we have to match a network, we can do it in literally well under a minute, and that's without doing any real optimization. So at the end of that process, what we have is this connected data structure where we now have parcels and buildings and jobs and households all interrelated. And we can now not only aggregate parcels to geographic areas, but also to streets. And we can crawl out along the street network and aggregate things very quickly. Now, this is what it looks like. This is just color coding to show the parcels that are matched by that network. By that matching algorithm to the nearest node on the local street graph. And we do this in a batch process across the whole 9-county region. And then we associate all these other attributes. So the data footprint is moderately large, but it's not overwhelming by the time we match all the data. We can still load it into memory and manipulate it pretty quickly. And of course, memory costs and capacities are changing radically as we speak. The other thing we're trying to do is reconcile the travel model network, which is what you see here in green, with the OpenStreetMap network, which has all the local detail and the correct graphics are much better. Any of you that have coded networks or looked at coded networks for the travel model know that they're hypothetical. We have nodes representing the endpoints of arterials or highway segments and then a straight line connector. So it's not a trivial challenge to connect these things, and we've created an interactive editor that, first of all, looks at the nodes at the endpoints of the travel model link, finds relevant nodes in the OpenStreetMap network, does a minimum path search to find the segments that most efficiently connect those two nodes, and uses that as a proposed match. And then we have an interactive editor that allows you to fix that or confirm it, and that's being used by the modelers at MTC right now to refine this matching process. The fast query part was a big issue for us. We wanted this to be extremely fast. And we're using an order of magnitude or two more features in the network. So performance would be a big issue. The basic idea in this contraction hierarchies approach is to create shortcuts. So it looks at a hierarchy of streets and identifies a hierarchical pathway that gives you a shortcut. And then it computes the shortcuts, stores them, and allows you to easily then trace a shortcut-based network very, very fast, and then unpack the components of that to retrieve the individual segments that contributed to that shortcut. And so I'll show you a little bit of benchmarking that we did using a standard Dijkstra algorithm implemented in the Boost graph library to the contraction hierarchies approach, and different reaches that we did going out from each node, a half a kilometer, 1.5, 2.5, 3.5 kilometers, which is going out pretty far. I don't really see much reason to go out 3.5 kilometers from every single node. The wonky scale is often going to be considered something like a third of a kilometer. It's going to be relatively modest and more in this range. But we went from 39 milliseconds to 5 milliseconds in just using that rate to find out how many nodes and which ones are within that radius of each node. Now, to start aggregating data, like how many jobs are there, how many retail shops, how many coffee shops, and so forth, that's an additional set of calculations to have to do. And we'll be able to internalize that and compare it with multi-threading and without. You see that we're now getting differences of 213 seconds to 2.8 seconds. So the speed up is really quite dramatic. And here's just another comparison showing the threaded approach and going out to different levels of reach. Clearly, it degrades as you get to very long queries where you're aggregating all the activities along that way. So the final part of this is developing an API that's generic, and we're thinking of setting this up as a service that is just available on the web and people can access and connect to it. The kind of things that we're putting in there are not just standard accessibilities, but also diversity and design measures. Are many of you familiar with the paper by Kara Kockelman and Robert Severo, the 3Ds paper? Okay, it's a good read. You should look at it. And it's been picked up by a lot of people since then. Density, diversity, and design for the initial 3Ds, and people have started adding many other Ds after that pattern got set. To basically try to capture what is it about the urban form at a local scale that influences people's travel behavior. And so what we're trying to do is capture all those kinds of metrics and incorporate them in this API so that we can rapidly do queries with any of these things. So we can do distance decay functions, different kinds of aggregations, measure densities and diversities like Shannon entropy, anything that connects to jobs or housing or households or building types, job sectors can be used in doing these calculations because all of those data are connected. And then then some design metrics include things like intersection design, density, number of parcels, size of parcels, block length, percentage of less than four-way intersection. And this can easily be extended. So these are just some initial ones that we've been working on. So in the end, what we can compute and visualize pretty readily are heat maps at parcel level, showing the values on the parcel that apply by going to its street node and reaching out and doing these calculations. So this one has non-residential square footage within a half kilometer. This one is residential square footage. This one is areas of diversity, residential, non-residential. It shows mixing of residential and non-residential. So it gives you a flavor for what kind of calculations we can do, and we can do them at this point pretty, pretty fast. So this is a walk score of our own making. We've now replicated walk score and done it within this algorithm, within this approach. But the good news is, a couple of pieces of good news. One, we completely control the algorithm, so we can make the weights anything we want, we can add other attributes, we can modify it, whereas walk score is proprietary and you can't do that. Second, because it's so fast, we can compute the Bay Area in 1.8 seconds, I think was the amount of time it took. So it means we could dynamically update things. If people are making updates to points of interest or other attributes, we could dynamically update this on the fly and make it very, very interactive. And this is the same thing shown in a greater level of detail. This is shown using fusion tables at Google. Some of you may have seen it or used it. Pretty easy to import something with lat long and attributes and show it interactively on Google-based map products. So that's it. What I think I'm going to do as I open up for questions is also let you have a look at what the system looks like. It's not just analytical maps, it's also 3D visualization. And we're getting down to, say, finally, something that looks more like a pedestrian escape. So we've also solved all traffic problems. Cars just disappear. So I conclude my talk with my remedy for traffic congestion. Just make the cars evaporate. Okay, so with that, I'm going to open it up for questions and discussion.
The API that you talked about to do all these calculations, is that maybe for use of the spread units, is it going to be integrated with the plan to be integrated with the street map? Or is it through this UI or
Yeah, so OpenStreetMap is very data-centric, and so they've got a great mechanism and infrastructure and a wonderful community to update and edit data and display it. But it's not an analytical engine. So what I think we'll probably do is rely heavily on OpenStreetMap and complement it and make sure that we can write corrections that are being made in any of our tools back into the OpenStreetMap community. So they're available there, but we also provide a complimentary service that's online so that if you're writing applications, you can write against that API and just like use a Google geocoder or something, you can also do these sorts of queries and generate results that you can use.
I think I saw Python listed on there somewhere. Is it Python query, but
it's
C underlying?
Yeah, it's C++ code. This whole graphical letter infrastructure that we're showing here is called Urban Vision, and it's all C++, and it's pretty highly optimized code. So, but we're trying to make it visible to Python, so we can make queries against it from easier scripting language. And we still have a lot of work to do to generalize and make this API available, but it's moving along pretty quickly. We're targeting to have this platform available for use in public workshops in January in the Bay Area. So we're on a good fast track to get it debugged and ready for use. Other questions?
I was wondering if the walk score for the Bay Area that you were just talking about, did you include data about pedestrian infrastructure, like width of sidewalks or?
Not yet. Not yet. And I don't think walk score does either because it doesn't exist. So it's mostly points of interest that are being used, and then the traversing of the street network. Some things that we can do easily, and I'm looking forward to adding in. Another thing that walk score doesn't have is terrain, whereas we actually do have terrain. And so we can then take into account that it's harder to walk up a steep hill than it is to walk either down the hill or along a flat space. So adding terrain in is going to be, I think, a valuable contribution. Connecting this to the transit system and doing transit score would be definitely a good direction to take this. And then to be able to also do all kinds of queries that use information on congested travel times from the travel model, which someday, in the not-too-distant future, will be based on local streets. It's not yet, but I think that's going to happen.
Well, it's amazing stuff. Thanks for sharing. This is something that a lot of us are very interested in. And ultimately, what we are trying to figure out is how do households make decisions about where to live and where to work. And since I have recently relocated, that's something that has been kind of, you know, more personally experienced. And one other thing that it came to my mind when you were talking is that we don't necessarily do multi-objective optimization. That is, we don't optimize all these different aspects that you're talking about simultaneously. We do it in some sort of a nested way. That is, we have some objectives that are much more important than others. So once we satisfy those objectives, then we look for the secondary objectives and find, do another search, a secondary search to satisfy those, and then do it in a nested structure. So, and I suppose that's easy to do.
Not so easy.
Okay.
And first of all, reacting to your first comment, I like to say that everybody is an expert on this topic. Everybody makes residential locations.
Yeah, right.
So, in that way, it's just like doing traffic. But you're absolutely right. So there are several choices that are interrelated. We were having this discussion a little earlier today. The workplace location choice, the residence location choice, the auto ownership choice, the school location, whether it's public or private school. All those are very intertwined choices. I would say even maybe the primary mode to work, your expectation of your preferences to be able to commute by something other than car would influence where you choose to live. It's not just the other way around. So it's a really thorny problem econometrically to wrap in a single simultaneous system all of those interrelated choices. So I would say most of what's being done so far is some form of simplification where you try to understand a hierarchy of choices and make some assumptions about which choices predispose other choices. But I think this is an area where there's a lot of active research about how to make connected choices and model them in ways.
But you could do something like a nested logic structure, I suppose.
The problem with that is your nest won't match my nest. Your nest today won't match your nest next year. So this year you might move residents because you're changing jobs. Next year you might change residences and hold your job. And your spouse might change jobs because you changed residence. So the nesting structures are all fluctuating and different. And this is a fundamentally hard problem. So there are some econometric tricks that have been brought to bear upon this. We were looking over a paper that I've done with Chandra Bhatt that looks at the residents' workplace choice. And part of this, we could take that, was to say there's some mixing of a predisposition to take one nesting structure or the other. And it's still not fully satisfying. So there's more work to be done here. Good motivation for PhD students, yes, to keep hacking away at these problems. Maybe one more here.
Oh, I'm just wondering, the photo you showed of the extremely wide freeway, where was that?
I think it's Photoshop.
It could have been taken out by the parking window.
It feels like a lot of places.
It doesn't know where to look.
I think you had your left person.
Could you explain again where the attraction type data was coming from and where that's getting, how it's continually updated as far as retail shopping, the attractions for the trips?
Oh, the attractions, okay.
Because I know WalkScore is kind of pulling in, some dynamic data, and how are you guys pulling that?
Yeah, I can't say I'm that familiar just now with all the sources that WalkScore uses. The unfortunate reality is that most of the reasonably good data is commercial and expensive. So you can buy, if you need access to things like the number of employees at the location, it's particularly difficult to get that. You either use employment securities records that are confidential and worry about their geocoding problems, or you buy data from Grant Street or Nats or Info USA and live with its rolling updates problems and various other artifacts. All these data sources have different problems. We did this experiment that I showed you in one of my slides, the open walk score, actually using just the open street map points of interest. And we were surprised at how good it was. There were a few deserts, a few places where we think the data is missing. But they were fewer than we expected. And this was something we just did in the last few days, so we haven't probed it very much. But I think there's there's a lot of potential for more use of open data, but the employment data is on the hard
part. I just have a time question about the predict the land use and to visualize it in 3D objectives. Because when I consider the 3D design of the cities, it's difficult to say in 20 years later what buildings we like. So I may give you the land use pattern of. I don't think it's a good way to demonstrate in this video objective. So.
Yeah, it's interesting. I've gotten very mixed and divergent reactions to the 3D visualization. We did this because MTC wanted it, and we were willing to pay us a lot of money to do it, and because it let me get some other things done that I wanted to get done. And I thought it would be kind of cool to work on, so we did. But some people react to say that if it's too realistic, Carrie, you mentioned this comment from your earlier work, that it tends to focus too much attention on the details that are not realistic. So maybe it diverts attention to the wrong places. But if you compare this to looking at blob maps or shaded maps or tables and histograms in a public meeting, I don't know which one will give you, a little more biased reaction. But it's an open topic, something we're going to be trying to learn more about. So I think we better